Hello, and welcome to the Water Research Foundation webcast, Environmental Impact of Asbestos Cement Pipe Renewal Technologies. My name is Jian Zhang. I'm a research manager with the foundation, and I will be the moderator for today's session. A considerable amount of AC pipe is still in service in North America, and it's not practical to replace them all right away. So according to the 2002 distribution system survey by AWWA, 18% of the North American potable water pipe inventory consists of AC pipe. This number should be lower now, but many utilities still have miles and miles of AC pipe underground. So the foundation has several other AC pipe related projects. Here are the links to the reports, to those reports. Now I'd like to introduce today's presenter. Dr. John Matthews has over 11 years of experience in the rehabilitation and inspection of infrastructure systems. He currently serves as a program manager and pipe rehabilitation specialist at Pure Technologies. Prior to joining Pure, he served as a water infrastructure lead at Battelle for 5 years. Today's webcast is actually based on the project John completed when he was with Battelle. And during that period, he did multiple studies for WRF, focused on the management of water pipelines. Before I turn this over to John, I want to remind the audience that you can download the slides from the webcast screen. I believe it's on the event resources. Also, the webcast will be available on the foundation's website by tomorrow. There will be a Q&A session after the presentation, so you can ask your questions directly through the webcast webpage by typing your questions either during or after the presentation. We will answer as many questions as possible as time permits, and we'll post answers to those questions that we don't get to. Lastly, it's important for us to hear from you regarding today's webcast. So before you leave, there will be a short post-event survey. Please take the survey. With that, John.
Okay, thanks, John. I want to welcome everybody to today's webinar. Thank you for taking the time to join us. While we talk about the environmental impact of asbestos pipe renewal, just a brief outline of what we're going to talk about. I'll give some overview of the project, sort of how the idea came about and what led to the study. Then I'll go through some of the specific project background, and that'll lead us into the two primary phases of the project. First phase that focused on basically a lit review, a search of regulations and research needs related to asbestos pipe renewal. And then phase two, where we did some actual field demonstration and technology evaluation, specifically focused on environmental impact evaluation. And we used two technologies during this project, pipe bursting and cured-in-place pipe. So we'll talk about those in detail, specifically the environmental piece. And then we'll go to some conclusions and some recommendations for further study. So first, a little overview. The initial project came about essentially with utilities calling myself and others, other researchers and others just in the industry and asking, what is out there, what's available when it comes to asbestos pipe renewal, you know, in lieu of replacement, what type of trenchless or non-trench options were out there, what were the regulations around that, and how could it be implemented? And so that got me thinking, talking to some other researchers, and it eventually led to a proposal to the foundation to look at this issue. There had been some studies, as Gianna mentioned, about asbestos pipe performance, but nothing specifically about renewal, and there was a lot of questions about it. What was allowed, what's regulated, what's not regulated. So we really wanted to jump into that question and hopefully try to answer it out. So this specific project was aimed at providing water utilities with answers to those questions. So we first looked at basically synthesizing the existing knowledge, what's out there currently, and we identified some data needs. That led us to phase two, where we actually demonstrated some technologies. And then phase three, which this webinar is a part of, is to actually inform stakeholder groups of what the findings were, and hopefully help move the process along going forward. So a little bit about the background. As Dion mentioned, the latest studies show about 18%. I've seen studies anywhere between 15 and 18% of pipes in North America, pressure pipes, distribution mains, being asbestos cement. Some utilities have much, much more, over 50%, over 60% in some cases. I suspect some of those may be joining us today. So there is a need to know what's available, how to renew, what's allowable. How can you help deal with both water quality issues and repair events without just replacing or abandoning in place, which some utilities do? As you may know, there's lots of technologies that have, I'd say recently, maybe in the last 10, 20 years, migrated from the sewer market that are now being used in water main repair and rehab. Obviously, they have to meet different standards in terms of water quality, but basically a lot of the constructability parameters and applicabilities are similar to the technologies developed for sewer. They're just being upgraded to handle the internal pressures. So those are some of the technologies that we reviewed in phase one to see what was really applicable to AC. So during phase one of the big focuses we wanted to do was to look at what the regulatory issues were. Asbestos at the highest level, at the federal level, is regulated by the National Emissions Standard for Hazardous Air Pollutants, or NESHAP, which is under the US EPA. They consider AC pipe in itself to be a non-friable material, which means it can be handled just by anybody. It's no special issues necessarily. But if it becomes regulated, or what they call RACM, if the material becomes friable, meaning the fibers within the asbestos pipe matrix can basically become airborne and be inhaled, or if that material has a high probability of being crumbled or pulverized due to whatever process you're doing. You think about somebody removing insulation in a home that has asbestos in there, and they're knocking it out with hammers or something like that. Now that could be very detrimental to the air quality. So that's really why this whole thing exists. Is to regulate how these materials are being repaired and being renovated. And so even though we're talking about pipe and we're talking about water, that's not necessarily related to air quality, you wouldn't think, but air quality does regulate asbestos in the U.S. And in 1991, the last bullet there, the EPA did have to issue some further clarification because the initial NESHAP did not address asbestos pipe repair specifically. So the question came up from many, both contractors and utilities, about what that meant from when it came time for them to replace their pipe. So there was some further quote-unquote clarification provided, but it actually created more uncertainty because specific technologies weren't addressed. It just went back to that definition of RACM. So if a pipe has a high probability to become crumbled or pulverized, it would be regulated and, you know, associated regulations would apply. And so does that mean pipe bursting? Does that mean lining? What does that mean? We're really not sure. So that's over 25 years ago. Since that point, there hasn't been a lot done to actually develop any data to warrant those regulations or not. So it's another reason for another timely reason to do this project. So that's at the federal level. At the state level, for the most part, most utilities follow NESHAP or some form of that. They have to follow NESHAP, but they can go beyond it, and some do. But for the most part, specific technologies or renewal methods are not prohibited by name. But again, they follow the definitions of RACM and the regulations within NESHAP, which require, when asbestos become friable, that the licensed contractor be used, or even the repair not be attempted at all and the pipe be abandoned in place. So different states deal with it differently. We did a survey of all 50 state agencies. Keep in mind, this was air quality agencies. Many of the ones I talked to personally on the phone were not aware of what I was talking about. They just reverted back to, we go by whatever NESHAP says. And so we were really trying to dig a little deeper and say, well, what do you do in this specific case? And they really couldn't answer it. So again, another need for the project. And then finally, at the local level, at the city or even regional level, there's different approaches. Again, they're held to NESHAP at the federal level, but they can go beyond if they want to. I only gave a few examples here. I meant to mention that the report is online, available to the public, because this was partially funded by EPA. There are many more examples of cities and regulatory agencies that do and do not prohibit different technologies and their justifications for doing so in that report. So these are just a few examples of cities that have anywhere from 21% in Houston to Sacramento Suburban Water District has over 50% AC in their system. Some are looking for different ways to replace or repair. In the instance of SSWD, was interested in pipe bursting but unsure of the regulation. It goes back to some of that confusion with the federal clarification in 1991. Some cities were just discarding in the same manner that you would an insulation from AC insulation. Others just abandon in place and mark it on the plans that there's AC pipe in the ground. They'll install a parallel line and just go about it and not worry about it. But there is a lot of confusion out there about what's allowed. We heard that from multiple utilities before the project and during. And so again, leading us forward to, we need to do some more digging, some demonstrations, and actually develop some data, or not develop some data, gather some data to see what it tells us about how impactful these technologies are to the environment. So again, no data had been cited that we could see that NESHAP was based on when it comes to pipe repair. So that led us to the conclusion. I mean, we brought in our proposal, but we let phase one also inform us of what we need to take phase two. And it led us in that direction. We need to gather some data. We need to look at what technologies are applicable, demonstrate them, but we also need to actually measure some environmental parameters and see if they are harmful or not. And obviously, we have a limited scope. So we did two technologies, but it gets the ball rolling. It gets us started so that we can move forward and potentially maybe gather more data in the future, but at least start to think about what the regulations are and why are they that way. So we did two technologies. We took air samples, water samples, and soil samples. I'll talk about those a little bit more in detail with the specific technologies, why we took those samples and what that means, but these are just the different test methods. Again, that will be there later, and all the details are in the report as well. So phase two, as I mentioned, based on the findings, we decided we'd do two demonstrations. One, pipe bursting, which is the technology that was the most controversial when it comes to AC. You think of the name, it says bursting. You may immediately, if you're not aware of it, think the pipe might be blowing up or something. So that may immediately make you think there's a rack-on issue here. And then cured in place, which is a well-established method on the sewer rehab market, a growing technology on the water rehab market, and something that we're seeing more and more of with all pipe materials, and being the access to the pipe and the disturbance of the pipe are quite a bit different. We wanted to have something to compare the pipe bursting environmental parameters to. So what we did is we had one program in Castleberry, Florida, where they've been successful in pipe burst quite a bit of AC pipe over the years, the last 6 or 7 years now. They've burst over 35 miles of AC, and they offered up a test site during our phase one webinar to discuss progress. And then Las Vegas Valley Water offered up a second site where they were just embarking on their very first CIPP lining, I think overall, not just on AC, of a highly critical 16-inch AC main, where they wanted to do a fully structural liner, and they weren't able to replace due to the nature of the location of the pipe. We also originally thought about doing a third site using a spray-on lining, but being that we're really more focused on the environmental impact and not just the technology applicability, we know spray-on lining is applicable to water mains, but the environmental impact was expected to be very similar to cured in place in terms of the access requirements to the pipe to do the repair, and also any disturbance to the outside of the pipe, which is very little. Obviously, you're just accessing the pipe through a pit. And so we decided to not pursue that, thinking that the impact would be very similar. So we stuck with these two. So we'll talk in more detail now about the first demonstration, which was the pipe bursting demonstration. This took place in Castleberry, Florida in August 2013. This was towards the end of their program. I think they just wrapped up their program last year, but they had been bursting since 2009. The specific location where we were, the AC had been installed in 1972, so going on 40 years. They'd had some breaks there, and they were also just trying to be more progressive with their replacement schedules. They were on about a 215-year replacement cycle, which is not that unheard of for many utilities that I've talked to. But pipe bursting allowed them to do more for less money in their market. And so they were able to replace quite a bit more and get a more manageable service life out of their pipes. This specific section was five bursts. They all average about 100, 155 feet in length, so total up close to 800 feet total. There were 8 and 12-inch mains in this section. They went in and replaced them all with HDPE, fusible HDPE. They used pre-chlorinated pipe bursting. We're not going to get so much into the detail of the construction process today. There is lots more detail in the reports. But today I really want to focus on the environmental impacts and what that data showed. But this just to give you some parameters about the technology. It was about 4 or 5 feet deep in most places. It was running under grass and asphalt. This was a residential neighborhood, operating pressure 60-65 psi. So very typical. See that picture on the top right there? That's when they were gaining access to put a pit for the pipe burst. So you see doing probably what typical abatement is, pulling the pipe out. They did wet cutting, pull the pipe out, wrap it up, tape it up, and ship it to appropriate disposal site, which is if you were replacing this entire 775 feet, this is what you would have to do section by section. So in this case, they're just doing it every 155 feet or so to gain access. And then at the bottom, you see the actual pipe string, where they're fusing the bursting head onto the section to be pulled into the ground. Again, I don't have lots of details in the slides about the actual construction, but we're going to talk more about the environmental impact. So what we did, again, we wanted to look at the asbestos in the air, the water, and the soil. And just a little background about that. Asbestos is harmful if inhaled. And so that's the reason why it is regulated by air quality districts, and that's the reason why the concern for the workers or pedestrians in the area, if you are disturbing a pipe and breaking it up, pulverizing, crumble, as was mentioned in that definition, that those materials could be inhaled and potentially cause long-term damage. And it's a very serious issue, especially for people that work in those environments constantly. And so we wanted to see what the environment was at a pipe bursting site. And to do that, we had to take air monitoring during the process at each of the critical, basically at each of the critical steps. We collected air for upwards of 2 or 3 hours at a time to see what the air quality was like, and then that was tested. And so that was the first thing. That's really the main thing that we wanted to look at. But since we're there, we also wanted to look at, were there any issues with the water quality? Asbestos is already measured as part of a water quality program with every utility. It's regulated by the EPA. There's an MCL, maximum contaminant limit. So we weren't really necessarily looking at, are you over the MCL? We were looking at, is there really a change before or after the bursting project? You may think it might actually go down because you're lining, which is possible. Others may think it might go up just because you're disturbing that pipe and maybe it finds its way into the water table or something like that. We weren't sure, so we tested it anyway. The last area that we measured was the soil. Again, not as big of an issue. There had been some discussion that if there was lots of asbestos in the ground and if the fibers became friable, somehow worked their way to the surface, or if the surface was disturbed from excavation, could those fibers become, again, airborne and become an issue again? So what we did was we took samples before the burst near the pipe and above the pipe and after the burst, and also from a pipe burst site that had been burst 5 years prior, to see how much difference there was. You know, is there a difference, and if so, is there an increase, and where is it at? And specifically with the retrospective sample, we wanted to see basically the volume, because we didn't have a baseline sample for that, and we wanted to see, is that a high number? You know, is that something that we would expect? So we did a very similar thing for the secured in place. I'll talk about that when we get there. There's a little bit of difference, but basically the same thing, because we wanted to compare across technologies to see if there was a difference. That was really the main focus for that. So just to jump in, and a lot of numbers here and maybe a lot of words, but it's very easy to summarize. This was from the air sampling. Again, like I said, samples were collected 3-4 hours at a time, basically before lunch, after lunch, during all the major construction activities. There was field blanks collected prior just to collect the general air quality, you know, outside of construction. And then we looked at different segments of the project and collected air from there. Basically, to summarize, all the air samples from this pipe bursting site tested below analytical sensitivity. Which of course means they're also below any OWA tolerance. We'll talk about that a little bit at the end. And so we didn't see an issue. We didn't necessarily expect this. We thought we might see something or at least register above sensitivity. I mean, there is a number reading, but it's below what is below the sensitivity of the technology to test it. So no fibers were detected during the pipe bursting. We compared this. This was one of the first projects that had ever collected this data from a pipe bursting site. Pretty sure it's the first one that's been published publicly. We were able to find two different studies that were not published publicly, but we were allowed to share those, and they're included in their report, where they had similar results. One was done actually in Florida as well, and another was done in Germany. So being this is only one site, we only had 6 samples, that's not a lot of samples, obviously. We felt better about our results when we can compare across projects and across time zones and continents to see something very similar. And the way that air was collected was also very similar. So we have some confidence there. Always you could have more data, but we do have confidence in the data. The second thing we looked at was the soil. We did baseline and post-rehab, again, just to compare. Again, a lot of words here, but the most important thing is there was only trace amounts of asbestos found in the soil, which again would be expected from an asbestos pipe that's been in the ground 40 years. None of it was harmful in any way. And before and after, there wasn't necessarily a trend. Actually, sometimes the trace amount went up, sometimes the trace amount went down. Sometimes, you know, it wasn't detected at all after some trace amounts were detected before. So it was really kind of random. You know, we couldn't really draw a lot of conclusions other than the amount is very low. So we didn't really see an impact. I think our hypothesis here was also that maybe we'll see that go up consistently. The pipe is being disturbed. You know, perhaps they'll be maybe not migrating high above the pipe. You know, we took samples above the pipe and then another foot or so below the surface. Maybe not that place towards the surface, but right above the pipe we thought, well, surely most of these will go up. We didn't see that. We saw some go up, some stayed the same, some went down. And this is consistent. Well, I'll talk about CIPP in a second. The final thing we looked at was water. Again, water is already regulated. It has a maximum contaminant limit. For the most part, we saw post-rehab, we saw very low levels of asbestos. This specifically was interesting because one of the pre-rehab samples had a very high number of asbestos structures, which was actually above the maximum contaminant limit. They think it was probably an issue with the amount of flushing they did. Either way, that could be an issue for their normal water quality standards. But after they did the rehab, it was very low. And again, it was actually below the maximum contaminant limit at that point. So just to summarize, before we do that, as we were going through the process for pipe bursting, the thought was, well, we're collecting our post-rehab samples, I think it was about 3 months after. The idea came from our project advisory committee that maybe we should look at something that's been burst quite a long time ago, or as long as we could get. We were able to find a pipe that was burst in 2009, the same utility, where we had all the background information. Of course, we didn't have baseline soil data, but at least we could look at it to see, is there something going on there? You know, does the asbestos migrate over time, perhaps, if there's a broken pipe in the ground? Again, it's only one data point, but what we saw was that there was only trace levels or non-detected levels, again, at the same locations. We had two pits. You can see the picture there. We took one above the crown. You see the ACP pipe in the ground there. And we took another one up near the surface. This was ideal because it was in a grass area, so we could dig it out very easily. And again, we didn't see anything there. So again, one data point only this time. Well, four data points technically, but we're not seeing an issue in the soil. So we're not very concerned about it based on our data to this point. So overall, in summary, for pipe bursting, environmental impact. We know pipe bursting is an applicable technology for rehab. We did air sampling. It didn't have a negative impact on the surrounding air while we were there. We saw two other studies that weren't published that are now cited in our work that showed similar results. Soil sampling showed only trace amounts of asbestos before and after. If there was an increase, it was only a trace amount. If there was a decrease, it was a trace amount or non-detect. I mean, there was really nothing to worry about and based on the data that we saw. And again, on the retrospective sample, no issue that we could see from a pipe that was burst. I think that was 5 years before when we actually took the data. On the water sample, we didn't see a negative impact on water quality. Asbestos didn't go up or go through the roof. I think probably the hypothesis was it would go down. Technically, it did go down. We don't know if that was just to do with the rehab or if that was more of an issue with the pipe to begin with. So we summarizing pipe bursting, we're not seeing an environmental impact to justify prohibition, which we've seen, I mentioned, in some regional air quality districts. And at the federal level is not prohibited. In fact, we'll talk a little bit more in detail. This project in Castleberry was actually co-funded with EPA money. We actually supported this technology, which was quite interesting. Okay, our second technology that we really did more as a comparison across different methods. I mean, pipe bursting is much more of a replacement. You're putting a new pipe within the pipe. You're breaking the whole pipe up. You're just using the real estate, basically. Cured in place, you can actually use the pipe as an interactive host. In this case, this is a fully structural liner, so it disregards the strength of the host pipe. It just uses it as a form, basically, to cure out. Again, much more detail about the technology in the reports. But it's very different in terms of disruption because the pipe is only disrupted to gain access at the pit where you see there on the right where they're pulling the liner in. That's it. The rest of the pipe stays intact and is not disturbed. So this was in Las Vegas Valley Water, December 2013. This was a 16-inch, like I mentioned, highly critical main. They had done some condition assessment. They were concerned about this having some future breaks. They've been very proactive based on the location, they did not want to have a break on this pipe. This was installed in 63, so about 10 years older, going on 50 years. They did about 3,100 feet of lining, 75 PSI operating pressure. This is a class 4, fully structural, glass fiber reinforced, cured in place. Nominal thickness was 7.5 millimeters. And again, this is run in a heavy traffic area in Las Vegas. So again, we wanted to look at asbestos in air, water, and soil. One main difference that's going to be shown in the results here is that we were not able to collect post-rehab soil samples. As I mentioned, this is not the reason, but it helped us justify. We weren't able to collect based on the location. I mean, once they covered those pits and asphalted back over, there was no way we were getting back in there. It's just the nature of where the project took place. It was a highly urban area. But based on the fact that pipe bursting showed trace amounts at most after pipe bursting, and CIPP lining is much less disruptive practically to the pipe. We didn't expect to see any increase there. I'll admit that's a hole in the data, something that would be nice to fill, but all data that we've seen which would suggest that there's not going to be anything there. But we did still collect the air, samples during construction, and we collected the water pre and post. So on the air, again, very similar to the first, and you'll see that all were below analytical sensitivity on the far right except for one. So one did actually register above analytical sensitivity, but it's still below what is considered hazardous. Actually, well below, you've got to go all the way up to 0.1 structures per cubic centimeters, and this was 0.0048. So definitely not something to be concerned about. In fact, it's something more like what we'd expected to see on a pipe bursting job. Again, I'm not basing that on anything other than bursting seems to be more disruptive than cured in place. So we did have something that actually read, but it was obviously well below the OSHA limit. So no concern there, and that's what we expected. Definitely after seeing the pipe bursting results, we expected this for CIPP, but even initially we expected to see not much. On the soil, as I mentioned, we're only able to collect the baseline results. We saw something very similar. We saw a few trace amounts at three samples and none at others. And again, post-rehab, I mentioned we weren't able to collect it due to the nature of the project, but we really wouldn't expect to see anything there. It's a hole in the data, but we would be very surprised if something showed up there, and would have to investigate further about why that would be, because I don't think you could attribute that directly to cured in place. And then finally on the water, we didn't see anything. You remember on the bursting, we saw something pre-rehab, nothing post. These were all below pre and post. So nothing major here. Again, not a huge issue, but just something we wanted to check to see if there was some kind of difference. So in summary, on the cured in place, air samples show no negative impact. Even though one sample actually read, it's not something to be concerned about. Soil samples only show trace. Water samples show no negative impact. So this is the first, definitely the first project that ever collected this data from a cured in place pipe project on AC. As the technology has only been very mature probably for 10 years and semi-mature for maybe 15 or 20, it's only been used on AC a few times. I've definitely seen it used in Canada on some AC. I talked to a few utilities in the U.S. that have used it. This was Vegas's first trial, and Vegas has quite a bit of AC, so they're very interested in the results. So this was a chance to get some original data that nobody had ever collected before, and it showed a negative impact. So we have those two data results from cured in place and from pipe bursting, really the first of their kind comprehensively. So just to summarize overall what we saw, 17 total air samples collected across the two sites. Just the one on the cured in place site that actually detected an amount, but it was well below the OSHA limits. So neither bursting or CIPP was found to have a negative impact on the air. And keep in mind the number of data points we have here. We know it's limited, but based on this data, this was our conclusion. And the air results match very well what we saw from the other two unpublished studies that were pipe bursting specific. When it comes to soil, again, very limited trace amounts of asbestos in the soil. Really no issue with it migrating. Again, only one site that we had there where we did the retrospective from the 2009 verse, but we didn't see any issue of migration of asbestos. I would definitely say more data could be collected to verify that. We weren't able to do the post-rehab on the cured in place, but we wouldn't expect any issue there due to the very little disruption that CIPP causes to AC. And based on this data, again, what we saw, we didn't really have anything else to compare it to, but this is all original data. Neither method was expected to have an adverse impact on the soil environment. So that was the conclusion we draw from the data we have here. And finally, on the water, very little on the water. We had 9 samples collected across the two sites. I think 8 that were actually tested. So only from the one pre-rehab did we see something that would be concerning. Not something that would be related to the technologies. You know, it's pre-rehab. We wanted to see what the change was. The change was it went down quite a bit. You know, it was below the NCL at that point. So we don't see an issue with these two technologies based on these two sites having a negative impact on water quality. So all that said, we didn't see an impact, you know, to conclude. We didn't see a great negative impact from using these technologies. So what are our recommendations from that? Where do we go from here? Specifically when it comes to the bursting, which was the technology that was causing all the confusion. You know, it's forcibly prohibited in some areas, and other areas it's just unsure. Some utilities are just not sure if we can do it, and it kind of frightens them if there is some issues there. I think the Castleberry project, which is detailed a little bit more in our report, and there's many publications out there about it, is a great case study of what you can do to completely meet all the requirements of NESHAP and still pipe bursting, and still pipe burst. And as I mentioned, to do it with funding from the federal government, I mean, they were bought into this. They saw the benefits of it. They listened to the utility when the utility told them they also had a great cost benefit to them. It was saving them lots of money. It was saving them time compared to replacement, and it was safe. They didn't have our data when they started their program. They did develop some air quality data, but our data also kind of reinforced that, at least from what we saw, their process, which was a similar pipe bursting process you see everywhere, it was safe, and they were able to meet all the requirements of NESHAP. And there are some requirements of NESHAP that definitely weren't designed with pipe renewal in mind, but they are being applied because it's asbestos material. So there was a little bit of a learning curve, and I think others that want to do this would look to Castleberry for leadership on how they were able to do that, and we document some of that in the report. But going back to the report, you know, what we were able to show is that we didn't see an adverse environmental impact. So what does that mean? The only way that NESHAP can be changed is through an act of Congress, which we wouldn't expect to happen, definitely not just for this reason or for others. But the alternative to that is during a meeting with federal EPA and some other regions, after learning more about the program in Florida, seeing some of their initial data, the initial recommendation from the EPA was to pursue what they call an administrator-approved alternative for pipe bursting specifically. That would basically allow it to be used for AC pipe renewal when these proper procedures that were established in Florida, out of necessity because they had to do the project, so they made sure they followed all the rules. When those are followed, the administrative alternative, approved alternative, could be used to allow pipe bursting in any case in the U.S. That has been pursued for a few years now, and so there's a task force that's leading that with some members from Florida and around the country. The issue there is there's never been one, to our knowledge, or to the knowledge of that committee, what they tell me, there's never been one of these pursued in any case with the EPA in its history that they're aware of. So they're really kind of working blind, trying to figure out what to do. So we hope that the data that we have started collecting with this project would be useful for that. And perhaps there's more data that's needed. We'll see. But that's sort of the recommendation. But where things were already going, but based on our data and what we've seen, we would recommend that process be continued and that they move forward with that administrator-approved alternative. Alternatively, just to highlight, I mean, we didn't see any issue with cured in place. We didn't expect to see it. We see it as a viable renewal alternative as well for structural rehab of AC water main. And then just a couple recommendations that came out through the course of the study about some issues that could be studied further. And I kind of highlighted a few, so I'm not going to jump on all of them, and there's more in the report. But one thing that came up, looking at the water quality, how does location affect that? So if you have 50% AC in your system, you know, where your locations are that you do your testing for water quality could be important. You know, how close are they to the AC sections? Are there multiple in the AC sections? Whatever that may be. To our knowledge, that hasn't been studied before. One of our project advisory committee members suggested that that's something that we or not we, but something that could be looked at by the research community in the future to see how that impacts those results. And so we would suggest, that be pursued. And then another thing, specifically with the soil, again, I hesitate a little bit to make this a recommendation because we really just didn't see anything other than trace amounts in any case before, after, or previously. But if you did want to do long-term testing and monitoring, it would be useful to have a baseline data point to compare to. So if you were bursting an AC pipe, if you could collect some soil samples at that time, they wouldn't have to be necessarily analyzed, or maybe they would. I'm not sure. We could look into it. But just to have that information for future studies would be useful. So if you wanted to go back to a similar location, collect the soil again to see if there's that migration issue, because for our one retrospective sample, we didn't have a baseline. We have baselines for our new samples, our new sections, so we could go back and do those in the future. But for this study, we didn't have it. So we think that would be something useful to collect for future study. So that's what I have for our conclusions recommendations. I do have several acknowledgments. As Gian mentioned, this project was completed at Battelle. Two key members from the Battelle team were Ryan Stowe and Dr. Sai Vaidya. Ryan, specifically on the bursting site, and Sai on the cured-in-place site, did a ton of work to coordinate and collect all that data. And then Jason Luke from Associate Engineering also provided lots of support, was a co-PI on the project, and provided some field support as well. So I have to acknowledge those guys. Our project advisor committee was very good, very active. As John mentioned, I've done several of these projects before. I think this is probably my favorite pack so far. So Laura Johnson with East Bay Mud, Shari Nandagiri at North Harris County, and Stephen Nash with Bowman Valley Water. Steve, being in Australia, had a different perspective on what they were doing down there and was able to provide a lot of the information. We included some of that in the report. Shwari had actually done some pipe bursting of AC in the past in Houston, and so that was good to get his perspective. And then Laura's perspective being that pipe bursting is prohibited in their district in California was interesting. So coming at from a completely different, like, we can't even, it's a non-starter for us to do pipe bursting, so it's very interesting to see them with the data set. And of course, Dr. Jen Zhang, the program manager, provided lots of support, did all the coordination with the PAC, and was very helpful in setting up webinars and other things as well. So, of course, acknowledge him. And then in terms of demonstration, there's lots of people I could acknowledge. so I just kind of started with the liaisons for each city, Alan Ambler, City of Castleberry, and Charles Scott, and also Las Vegas Valley Water. And there was lots of others with both groups and contractors involved and support staff. And, frankly, we had lots of other people on our project team from different utilities providing feedback and reviews, and so this could go on and on. There's a long acknowledgement page in the report where we try to highlight as many of those people as we could. So I want to acknowledge all them and thank them for their support. And from there, Gian, I think we're about ready for questions.
Great. Thank you, John, for the presentation. Now it's time for you, the audience, to ask questions. And we now do have several questions coming in. The first question, John, is posted by a gentleman who missed maybe some discussions of your pipe bursting. So the question is, assuming that some of the burst pipe rehab require the reconnection of lost services, what special precautions were required to be taken by workers making those reconnections? And were there any airborne fibers detected in the excavations?
Yeah, so basically in terms of reconnecting services, we had somebody at those locations while they were doing that work as well. So we considered that one of the primary activities. So we were collecting air samples at that point as well. And I can't speak to the other two cases. One I can. The other one in Florida was very similar to ours, and so they did the same thing where they collected air at all the major activities where the AC was being disrupted. The case I mentioned in Germany, Gian may laugh about this. I had to translate that one and because it was in German and do some QAQC on it. And I don't remember specifically if they collected data at that point either. But at least our data and the other Florida data reflects that in the results.
All right. Thank you, Gian. So the next question is, can you clarify if the high asbestos pre-rehab sample, I believe, is missing. If it was just a sample of the water during normal operations or during a flushing event of the line?
Yeah, I think that's documented in the report. I want to say it was part of the flushing event and not part of the normal operations, but I could be wrong. But I'm pretty sure that was the case.
All right. So is there a location where we can find the proper procedures used?
Yeah, we put in quotations proper procedures. We documented those for the Castleberry project specifically, and we also referenced Alan specifically, Alan Ambler, who I acknowledge, has published quite a bit on their program over the years. And he talks in there, I want to say we did as well in our report, but he talks in there in great detail about how they were able to meet each of the requirements of NESHAP. We definitely included reference to that. We may even talk about it a little bit in detail in the report. So I would say start with our report. If it's not there, you can ask me specifically at that point, and I can probably just give you the Alan's references, but they should be also listed. So it's very detailed information out there about how they went about doing this. They had to be very public about it. Again, they were using federal funding for this. So it was very transparent. And also, they wanted to make it easier for others to do it in the future. They speak to utility groups very often about it.
All right. Thank you, John. So here's a long question. How is pipe bursting and resulting AC pipe debris on completion inside pipe track at depth now assessed by US EPA as a waste site and ongoing management requirements?
Yeah, so that's a good question. We talk about that a little bit on the report. That's one of the requirements of NESHAP, the fact that the pipe debris is left in the ground creates what's called an active waste site. The fact that it's not disturbed after you're done bursting and you just pave over and everything goes back to normal. I think after 1 year, it becomes an inactive waste site. So there's some requirements where that has to be noted on either a deed or made some kind of public notation, because public property typically doesn't have a deed, at least in Florida. So some of those issues are described in the report about how Castleberry dealt with that, and there's more information out there from Alan on what they did. But it's something that it's just, again, it's one of the issues that they had to deal with in terms of NESHAP. So it is important to take that into account and how that has to be documented.
All right. Yeah, by the way, I want to repeat that this report is available for in the public domain of our website, the foundation's website. So you can just go to our website and download it. All right, John, so next question is, how does EPA landfill regulations apply to the pipes that stay in place after bursting?
That would kind of go back to the same comment from before. The site is considered an inactive waste site, or an active waste site, I think, for up to a year, and then it goes to an inactive waste site, where basically it just has to be documented on a set of plans or a deed. Moving forward, that's John's probably dumbed down version of probably what it really is. But essentially, talking to Alan, that's basically what they had to do. There's more detail in the report or in some Alice's references about the way he had to do that. But it's doable.
Okay. Another question: what is an EPA administrator approved alternative, and how does it affect the NESHAP?
Yeah, I touched on this a little bit. So there's never been one pursued as far as the task committee is aware. So they started by just documenting the process of pipe bursting, documenting how they've met the steps of NESHAP. They've also met with the EPA, showed them you know, this is what a pipe bursting site looks like. Many of them were quite surprised at that point. When you hear the word burst, just naturally you think that there's an explosion happening or something like that. And to see a pipe bursting site, for those of you that have, you know, basically have a pit, you know, a couple hundred feet apart, and, you know, there's something going on in the ground, but, you know, you don't really see anything. I mean, there's not explosions happening. The pipe just being broken up and pushed into the soil. And so because of that, the EPA was of the mind that this should not necessarily be prohibited. And the fact that it was meeting NESHAP anyway by addressing, because the category had to do that, they were just going through meeting the requirements. Nobody had ever done that. The EPA felt comfortable by telling them if you pursue an administrator-approved alternative, the NESHAP would not have to be changed by Congress, and therefore a pipe bursting could be used, you know, anywhere if you apply these standard procedures. That has not moved forward, as far as I know, since. So we're working on this project. That was in the process. They were waiting for this data to include as part of that submittal. I have not talked to anybody from the task committee recently, so I don't. But I don't think that's actually gone forward. But the plan would be that would go forward to the EPA for approval, and then you wouldn't have to go change NESHAP to just say, you know, this is what's allowed. You would just have essentially, I think an AAA serves as kind of like an addendum that says if you follow these procedures, you can use this technology. And so that's the process that's being pursued. There's no roadmap to do it, and so it's a little murky about how to get there. But that's the plan going forward.
Great. Thank you, John. Here's the next question. How are future repairs performed with regards to workers' exposure within the excavation that contains burst AC pipes?
Yeah, so it would be similar to the same repair methods that are used now. So when you go out to do a burst repair or something like that, or a leak repair on AC, it's very similar. I mean, the pipe, maybe I should have showed a picture of that. I don't know if I have a really good one, but once a pipe is broken up, it's not like it's in gravel bits or something like that where it's just part of the soil. Typically, it's in big pieces that are just kind of sunk into the soil. And so it's not necessarily a different type of hazard you're working with. You're still just working with an AC pipe. It's just pieces of it in the ground. So if you were going in to repair that that HDPE, you would need to know there was AC there, which you would know because, like I said, that would have to be documented as part of the NESHAP requirement on your plans or on your deed. And then you would just have to deal with it in the same method that you would do by your local state standards, which is typically sometimes you have to have a permit or you have to have a prior approval, except in emergency cases. And so those same conditions would apply for a pipe burst site.
All right. Thank you. So one of your recommendations is that the EPA administrator-approved alternative should be pursued for pipe bursting. Is there a need for additional data before pursuing such a, you know, EPA AAA?
Yeah, I think so that's really unknown. As a researcher, I tend to think yes, because sometimes we think, I'm not a full researcher now, I shouldn't say that, but when I was a full-time researcher, that's the way you always think, is that you could probably never have too much data because you never know what it's going to say. I mean, our hypotheses were wrong many times on this project. We thought we were going to see a lot more impact from lots of the different tests. And then we saw a pretty rehab sample where the asbestos was not through the roof but over the MCL. So you never know what the data is going to say. So more data always helps, I would say. But the fact that the AAA has never been pursued, we don't know what the requirements are. That was not necessarily our goal with this project. It was just to produce a lot of data for that specific case. Our goal was to produce data that said what was actually going on. And so that's why I preferenced all of my conclusions by saying, you know, for our two sites plus our retro site, this is the conclusions that we can draw. More data makes a stronger case. That's just the way it goes. So I think we won't know that until the administrator alternative is submitted. And even if our data would be used as part of that, I couldn't tell you that for sure. I think it should be used. Either way, I would say if our data were to come out and show that the impact was quite negative, it should definitely be used in that case too. But it should be used to show this is the data that's been produced by the research industry, and then the conclusions can be drawn from that. So if more is needed, that would be up to the research community to produce it.
All right. Thank you. Here's another question, really long. So I'm reviewing USA Butterworth study and UAQUIR studies and international study applying assessment of water, soil, and air should adopt consistent approach and standard methods. Direct comparison of PCM testing performed in UK and Australia with TEM ISO 10312 should be assisted by reporting PCMETM data. What are your thoughts here?
Yeah, I would say, so I could have mentioned that as well. There's multiple test methods for all three of the parameters that we evaluated, water, soil, and air. We chose the specific method for air so that we could direct compare to the Florida study. That was the only one we knew existed at the time. We found out later about the German study. And if there's other studies that use different test methods, there needs to be some evaluation about the differences there, if there's a different sensitivity specifically. But as long as the sensitivity, this is my point of view, as long as the sensitivity is below the level, the maximum contaminant level, there shouldn't be an issue. There could be a comparison of different test methods to see if that makes a difference, and probably I'm just jumping the gun here, but if there is a major difference in the sensitivity of two methods to where one can test only above a contaminant level, then it is an outdated test and doesn't need to be used. So ours, in this case, were all below contaminant level tolerances, so that's all you need to know for our case. When you're looking at data across the board, you would need to know what test method was used. But again, as long as you're measuring to a certain contaminant level, it should be applicable. It should be comparable. We run into that issue quite often with other tests and other things, specifically internationally. But even in the U.S., these are different U.S. test methods that I'm referencing in my mind. But there's obviously different test methods all over.
Right. Thank you. And by the way, this is a question from Melbourne, Australia. So they have done a lot of AC pipe work there.
Absolutely. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Thank you. I think these are all the questions we have received so far, and pretty much it's time to end this webcast. I want to thank our speaker, John Matthews, for his excellent presentation, and thank our audience for the great questions. And thank you for attending the webcast. Don't forget to take the short post-event survey. Let us know how you think about today's webcast so that we can improve in future webcasts. Thank you.
Thank you.